Enrique Penalosa, the former mayor of Bogota.
Okay, thank you very much. Bogota is not as large as Mumbai, certainly, but has 7 million inhabitants, and it has a very high density, about 220 inhabitants per hectare. I'd like to first say that if we have private property and a market as the best way to manage most of society's resources, there is not much we can do about income inequality. But we can do a lot for quality of life equality, especially for children. Quality of life in terms of housing, of health, of access to parks, recreation, and music lessons, sports, education. It is realistic to strive for a city where nobody feels inferior or excluded. I'd like to first mention that in the transition from 35% urban to 75% urban population, in Latin American cities, population in Latin American cities grew by more than 1,000%. Population of Indian cities will be, India now has about 35% urban population, as I understand. Therefore, if the same were to happen, population in Mumbai would be 10 times what it is today in 40 or 50 years. Maybe that will not happen, but at least it will be 3 times more. But I don't see any reason why it would be very different than what happened in Latin America, but let's say it will be at least 3 times as much. There are slums in practically all developing country cities. Therefore, the slum problem is not because we have had a bad government or a bad mayor or a bad president. The system of private property of land does not work for the case of land around cities. Because if it was a matter of a bad government, maybe there would be some cities where the problem would not exist. Clearly, what it does not work is the system of private property of land, what is not working anywhere in the world. This is in Dar es Salaam, you see. There are no streets, nothing. It's a very curious case of messiness. Or in Philippines, the Asian type of slums around railroads, always. This is in Kenya, in Nairobi. The inputs for housing are land, construction, materials, labor, and finances, which can be final income, loans, government subsidies. As countries get richer, all inputs become more accessible. Construction materials, higher salaries, higher finances, but land does not increase. Land is as inaccessible as at $8,000 income per capita, and it is at $300 per capita. Because private property does not work, and free markets do not work in the case of land around developing country cities. Rice supply increases when prices go back down. This is the essence of the market of capitalism. This does not happen in the case of land for housing. We can increase prices all we want, and the supply of land, which is accessible to utilities, to jobs, to schools, does not increase. Therefore, I do not understand why we still continue to adopt private property as the means to manage most land around the jungle. And very soon, land is inaccessible to people, even though land was free 10 years before. 10 years later, it's totally inaccessible to people, even when you find some oil, for example, or whatever. This is just pictures of Colombian cities all over the place. And then you can see the land. You know, the owner of this land is very happy about this illegal development because then the government has to bring water and roads and buses, and then this land goes up very much in price. It's very likely that the owner himself gave this half free to these people so he would force government to bring utilities there. It really happens very often. In Bogota, this is the surroundings of Bogota, where about half the city initially started out as illegal. Bogota is very high up in the mountains, about 2,600, but these slums are even much higher up. Illegality, of course, leaves poor public spaces, inadequate locations, no parks. Adjacent to Bogota, there are tens of thousands of hectares of flat land, but the poor continue to be forced to illegal neighborhoods because the land is private, and if people have higher incomes of lower interest rates or whatever, or higher government subsidies, then whatever we gain from subsidies or from higher income, then land prices go up and you lose whatever you have gained elsewhere. So you can never catch up. It's like the dog, the rabbit in the dog races. It doesn't matter how fast the dog races, it will never catch the rabbit. So this is the new slums growing up. This was a severe failure of the Colombian state, that half of Colombian cities grew out initially as slums, in some more and some less. My respectful suggestion is, in order to avoid the same mistake, Indian government should acquire most of the rural land around its cities, or else the same thing will happen and Mumbai will be two or three or four times as big and the problems will only get bigger, as architect Charles Correa was mentioning before, that this is not going to be solved if we continue to do the same. We have to do, therefore, as everywhere, two things. One, slum improvement, make slums legal, supply them with water, sewage, schools, parks, public transport, pedestrian and bicycle infrastructure. But also we should do something to avoid the city from continuing to growing in slums. What is it that we are going to be doing? One thing is to dissolve what they exist, but then what to do so that they don't grow in the future. We have legalized in Colombia traditionally slums. This is more or less in the process of improvement now. Legal, I mean, as they are so freely, so almost legal, so they really have streets and... Then we put all services and then becomes the legal city, the normal city, like this. And we improved a lot like this, and then with shops and a normal city in the working. Colombia has a very... utilities have a very high cross subsidies. Upper income people may pay up to 10 times more for the same water as the poorer people. And this is how about 100% of homes in Bogota have running water and electricity. Practically 100% are connected to sewage systems. More than 90% have drainage system. Nearly 90% have pipe gas through cross subsidy system. Beyond making low-income neighborhoods legal and providing them utilities, I would like to emphasize on something different. Measures can be taken in order to truly create inclusion, a sense of belonging, and even of pride, respect for human dignity. Small public works with high community participation can strengthen community organization and create self-esteem. But we have to work on pedestrian infrastructure. I mean, we cannot just simply put roads through the slums or through poor neighborhoods. Because these are for cars. We have to make infrastructure for people. Sidewalks, parks, schools, libraries, infrastructure for people. So this is the type of thing. We made hundreds of these things. Communities themselves proposed them, designed them, and go on contracts with them to be built. Smaller pedestrian streets like this, or sidewalks, stairways such as this. But I'd like to emphasize that the real conflict for space and funds in cities between cars infrastructure, the real conflict is between cars infrastructure and social infrastructure, such as schools, libraries, hospitals, and parks. If we really want to solve the problems of the poor, we have to make a very crucial political decision, and it's somehow decide that we are going to make more and more and more and more highways every time we have a traffic jam. Because there is a huge conflict for space and for funds. If we decide that every time we have a traffic jam, we are going to make bigger highways, it will never be possible to solve the needs of the poor in poor cities. Like temples, quality buildings are symbols which create values, such as churches where in medieval towns, children's nurseries, schools, libraries. This is, for example, in a very poor neighborhood, top quality school with the best architecture and conditions. Or this one here, and you can also see the mass transport here. Another top quality school in the border of the city, very, very high up in the mountains. Schools like this in the poorest neighborhoods. Here, even a pedestrian street only in the poorest neighborhood, and then community centers, indoor swimming pools, schools. Here we made this library, great library. Then this this was very poor around here. Then this attracted a little bit higher income developments, even shopping areas. And, of course, this whole area. Dispensing free food can help the poor, but it does not create equality and self-esteem. Good. Architecture for people, not for motor cars, can create equality and self-esteem. And I'm not an architect, I must say. this is a picture of lack of democracy. Clearly, in this society, car owners are more important than pedestrians. This is a picture of underdevelopment, of lack of respect for human dignity. This is in Nairobi. Clearly, the road is well paved, but the pedestrian spaces are just mud. Again, in Dar es Salaam, people do not exist except if they are car owners, even children, even school children. Public pedestrian space is a symbol of respect for human dignity. So if we are going to improve slums, we have to make investments in pedestrian, quality pedestrian spaces. In low-income communities where people do not have cars, quality pedestrian infrastructure creates inclusion and equality.
I'd like to show this is through some of the poorest areas in Bogota. We made a 23-kilometer pedestrian street. Very high quality, even underground cables and the like. In some areas, there was no city yet, and then this was land bought by government for housing projects. The artery for the development was the pedestrian street. This is an interesting project. See, underground cables, pedestrian space, bicycle way, and the cars in the mud.
It's different values, I mean.
The new city begins to grow around the pedestrian street more than around a car street. See, normally, this is the typical illegal development in the process of advancing and legalizing. Normally, the car pavement would have been done first. This we did first. First for pedestrians and bicycles, after for pavements for the cars. Different values are created. Respect for humans. Children going to schools, the bicycle shops open next to it.
See the lady, see again the car in the mud, the pedestrian street next to it. Children going to. This is a different concept. I think we should have a network of hundreds of kilometers of pedestrian streets. How wide should sidewalks be? As wide as you can make them.
Then in a thing we made infrastructure for pedestrians next to poor neighborhoods.
To enjoy them, the waterfront. To go out to the countryside in pedestrian street. Next to canals, all next to drainage canals should be pedestrian spaces. What you can do with a drainage canal and not some pedestrian infrastructure. A protected bicycle way is not a cute architectural feature in a city. It is a right, unless one thinks that only motor vehicle owners have a right to safe mobility. Even the poorest have a bicycle. A protected bicycle way is a symbol that shows that a citizen on a $30 bicycle is as important as one on a $30,000 car. So now, from almost 0% in 7 years, Bogota now has 5% of its population using bicycles every day. They are saving 1.5 monthly minimum wage every year. In fancy bridges for bicycles. Large roads are necessary, but they must have quality pedestrian infrastructure next to them,
next to poor neighborhoods. If we are going to build them, but make
nice pedestrian spaces next to these neighborhoods. Public pedestrian space is not a luxury. It's as necessary as hospitals or roads. In the future, low-income citizens will have access to most goods high-income citizens have today, computers or mobile phones. Access to green spaces will be a crucial source of inequality or equality if we really create parks, such as central parks and things like this. Parks and plazas are as necessary, again, as roads or hospitals. This, we demolished downtown with a huge social program, 23 hectares to create a park in the middle of some downtown area. Again, space for children, space for cars, the same picture. Parks in the poor neighborhoods. Parks are important, again, even in the poorest neighborhoods. artificial turf soccer fields, large parks in the middle of the poorest areas. And we buy even land for the future, even if we don't have money to make the park yet. And now, to finish, the idea again is not just to solve the slum problem, but to avoid them. So I think we have to buy land in advance next to it. So national government gives $4,500 subsidy for $1,500 houses. We created an agency which buys land next to the city, either voluntarily or through eminent domain, at rural prices. But it's private developers who build the houses, but they have only 2 years to develop this, to build the houses, and their maximum price of $15,000. This is the type of developments with lots of parks, well-designed. This is the type of slums that were there before, and this is the new type of development with a lot of infrastructure, pedestrian. This is the type of houses, 40 square meter houses for $15,000, and they can add up another 20 meter. And we get very high densities, about 340 inhabitants per hectare, sidewalks. Some of them are with higher densities like this. And this is the land, yes, this is the land next to Bogota. And as rural land, right there, you see the city right there. This land should not be privately owned. Although it's outside the urban area, this land is adjacent to it. With good public transport, this land is only 25 minutes from downtown. This land around developing country cities, and even land which seems very rural in Mumbai today, should be publicly owned. I know, for example, of some Latin American investors which have a lot of land around Indian cities. I think it's very absurd that this is becoming a speculating feature, because this is the main obstacle to solving the needs for housing with good quality public spaces and good planning. So I really would suggest very respectfully that the Indian state at any level which is relevant should acquire all or most of the land, the rural land around the cities, because it's very likely that the cities will grow much farther than what you imagine today. With good public transport, all of this land can be accessible anywhere in the city. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Enrique. You always inspire us and challenge us, and we look forward to more conversations.